Hello everyone. So in today's video, we're going to go over this paper by Zehra Wasim and Doug Hovey titled Hateful Symbols for Hateful People, Predictive Features for Hate Speech Detection on Twitter. So this is a classic paper from 2016. And when compared to the papers I read and discussed in the previous videos, this is one of the papers which started it all. So it gives quite a few good ideas, and we can see how the field itself has evolved. Alright, so in the abstract we discuss how hate speech is a form of racism and sexism, and it is very common on social media platforms, and it is largely manually done right now. So all the moderation is largely done manually, and it varies a lot. So there can be multiple different forms of hate speech. And at the time this paper was written in 2016, the new predictive models had not yet arrived on the field. And there was no largely accepted definition for hate speech. So different platforms use their own different definitions. So in this paper, they provided a list of criteria founded in the critical race theory, and use them to annotate a publicly available corpus of more than 16,000 tweets, and then analyze it using different linguistic techniques. Alright, so in the introduction, they discuss how hate speech is a very serious issue, and there are a lot of different issues at hand. So when people censor or block people due accounts due to hate speech, if social media platforms do that, then the problem of violating the right of freedom to speech comes into play. So a very delicate balance needs to be maintained. And then they discuss the detection moderation part, and it's basically they conclude that if the earlier the detection made, the more damage can be prevented. So in many cases, we've seen that online hate speech results in violence and even offline or physical action. So that could be prevented. Then they discuss how different platforms such as Twitter and Facebook are actively trying to combat and have taken initiatives. But then problems such as bias in human annotators comes into play. Or how does one decide what definition of hate speech to use? Or maybe something which is offensive to some person might not seem offensive to some other person. So all of these issues were there at play. In spite of these reasons, NLP research on hate speech has been very limited, primarily due to the lack of general definition of hate speech. And this is the problem which they tackle. While online hate speech is a growing phenomenon, its distribution is not uniform. And this is a very important thing which they take up in this paper. So neither is the awareness of what constitutes hate speech. For instance, at that point of time, most of the hate speech on social media platforms was unevenly distributed, and there were a few people who were pumping out much more hate speech as compared to others. So that demographic data was also an important feature which they included. So in the end, the paper provides a data set of 16,000 tweets annotated for hate speech. They also investigate which of the features give the best detection or classification performance. So which features of the hate speech dataset can be used to identify hate speech in the best way possible. They also analyze features that improve detection and find that despite presumed differences in the geographic and word length distribution, they have little to no effect, positive effect on performance, and rarely improve our character level features. The exception to this rule is gender. Alright, so we'll see how different features entangle and complement each other. So this point will be more clearer when we go ahead. Also, the dataset which they used was collected over 2 months. They retrieved a total of 136,000 tweets and annotated 16,000 of them, approx 17,000. 3,383 were sexist, sent by 613 users. 1,972 were racist, sent by 9 users. So you can see it's concentrated, highly concentrated amongst few users. And 11,559 were neither sexist nor racist and sent out by 614 users. Since hate speech is real, but a limited phenomenon, we do not balance the data to provide as realistic a data set as possible. So this is why you can see hate speech is much less as compared to all the normal number of tweets. And this should be quite a relief for us, because we don't really want hate speech to overpower all other messages and just have our social media platforms turn into hate speech spreading platforms. So they've published a dataset on GitHub with tweet IDs and labels. Alright. So corpus collection. We bootstrapped a corpus collection by performing an initial manual search of common slurs and terms pertaining to religious, sexual, gender, and ethnic minorities. So they were looking for specific terms and phrases inside the tweets. In the results, we identified frequently occurring terms and tweets that contained hate speech and reference to specific entities, such as the term hashtag MKR, and which is the hashtag for the Australian TV show My Kitchen Rules, which often prompts sexist tweets directed at the female participants. So then they could use this hashtag to identify more such tweets. In addition, we identified a small number of prophilic users from these searches. As we discussed, racist content was only like the tweets, 1972 tweets were from 9 users. So that makes sense. So using this, they used the Twitter API to collect the entire corpus, filtering for tweets not written in English. Makes sense, because the data set is their work is primarily targeting the United States. This particular corpus construction ensures that we obtain non-offensive tweets that contain both clearly offensive words and potentially offensive words, but remain non-offensive in their use and treatment of the words. For instance, even though Muslims is one of the most frequent words in racist tweets, it also occurs in perfectly innocuous tweets such as "You are right, there are issues, but banning Muslims from entering does not solve anything." So this tweet in itself is not hateful, right? But if the classifier or the annotators were just outright moderating on the basis of the presence of certain words, then this tweet would also be classified as hateful, and that would be a problem. So they manually annotated a dataset, after which they had the help of a 25-year-old female woman studying gender studies and a non-activist feminist to review the annotations and to mitigate the annotator bias. Alright, so they have the dataset available as well on GitHub. So let's just have a look. Okay, so all of them have Twitter IDs, and this is one of the problem with these datasets. These datasets get lost very easily. You may ask why? Because all of these datasets have Twitter IDs, tweet IDs, which get deleted or which are censored or removed by the social media platforms themselves. Alright. So identification annotation. While it is easy to identify racist and sexist slurs, hate speech is often expressed without any such terms. Right. There is implicit hate speech as well, where no term would be found, but a human can easily identify that this is hate speech. Furthermore, it is not trivial for humans to identify hate speech due to differences of exposure to knowledge of hate speech. Right. So there can be other types of hate speeches as well, where some person might think that this is hate speech, while some others may think, okay, this might be a bit offensive, but this is not exactly hate speech. So there's a lot of bias and debate on that as well. Similarly, to identifying privileges, a critical thought process is required to identify hate speech. In order to reliably identify hate speech, we need a clear decision list to ensure the problematic tweets are identified. And they provided these criteria, and the criteria are partially derived by negating the privileges observed in Macintosh 2003, where they occur as ways to highlight importance, ensure an audience, and ensure safety for white people, and partially derived from applying common sense. Alright, so they used this previous work, and then they did their own research and created these set of guidelines. So you can just have a look at them. Uses of sexist or racist slurs, attacking minorities, seeking to silence minority, criticizing a minority without a well-founded argument, promotes but not directly use hate speech or violent crime, criticizes a minority using strawman argument, blatantly misrepresents truth, shows support to problematic hashtags, negative stereotypes, defends xenophobia, sexism, contains a screen name that is offensive, Right. So, as in that paper highlights the way that they are privileged by being white, many of these observations underline apparent safety and visibility granted by skin color. As such, our list highlights ways in which minorities are undercut and silenced, as these occur as methods of oppression of minorities. Right. So, I guess this part was quite self-explanatory. They've set up these guidelines. So, while a lot of this is easily identifiable, if someone is using a racist or sexist slur, then it can be easily identified. But how do you define which hashtag is problematic? These are unclear. So they define problematic hashtags as terms which fulfill the remaining one or several of other criteria. Alright. So now we have the annotator agreement. So the inter-annotator agreement is CAPA 0.84. 85% of all disagreements occurred in annotations of sexism, while 98% of all reviewer changes being set to neither sexist nor racist, the remaining set to racist. So what I'm trying to say is that annotators agreed on approximately 84% of the data. So both of them identified it as the same type, be it racist, sexist, neither or both, or whatever the classes they have. Next, they discuss where did the problems arise. So out of the disagreements, 85% of them were in the annotation of sexism. And when we had the reviewer there, the reviewer reviewed them and assigned 98% of the cases to be set to neither sexist nor racist, and the remaining to be set to racist. In most of the cases, we find that disagreement is reliant on context. Okay, so you need some additional context to actually appropriately decide if it is sexist, racist, neither or both. Where an outside annotator would tend to annotate such cases lacking apparent context as not being sexist, we prefer to annotate as sexist for many of these cases. For instance, our outside annotator did not find they're just horrible lemon tarts MKR to be case of sexist language, whereas we had annotated it as such. Alright. So another common case of disagreement was the difference of opinion in what constitutes sexism, where we found tweets such as, alright, I won't read them out, to be singling out a single woman. Our annotator found that such a comment was not coined on gender, but in fact an assumed expression from a hard work from the competitor. Alright. So they describe how and in which places did the annotators and the reviewers disagree, and I shouldn't have really read this tweet, so I'm sorry about that. Alright, for the demographic distributions. So Twitter does not directly provide feeds for demographic information beyond location. So they collected this by proxy. They looked up the user's profile name and compared them to well-known female and male names, as well as indicators of gender such as pronouns, honorifics, and gender-specific nouns. They found gender distribution heavily skewed towards men, and while men are overrepresented in the dataset for all categories, the majority of users cannot be identified with our method. Right, so 50% were identified to be men, but 47% were unidentified. For instance, in our racist set, we only identified 3 out of 9, all of them men. Furthermore, Robert et al. 2013 find that 87% of perpetrators of hate crimes against African Caribbeans and Asians respectively were men. Considering that hate speech is a precursor to hate crime, we find it unsurprising that such a large part of the perpetrators of hate speech in our dataset are men. Alright, so I think this is quite self-explanatory, and this was quite easy to understand because this was just reporting some commonly known facts. And while we managed to identify 52% of the users in our annotated database, we find that the vast majority are users associated with sexist tweets and tweets that do not contain hate speech. Given that both nearly have the same distribution, we do not expect this feature to yield a substantial increase in F1 score. Alright. So, where did they identify 52% of the users? Let's see. Okay, in the entire database, they find that the vast majority are users associated with sexist tweets and tweets that do not contain hate speech. Alright, so this means that they have similar distributions, so we cannot expect some good distinctions being made when we add these scores into our model. are these features. So we normalize the data by removing stop words with the exception of not. So if you're not familiar with stop words are words which do not give context. So for instance, if you had the sentence geeks for geeks, a computer science portal for geeks. So if you remove the stop words, you get geeks for geeks, computer science portal geeks. This is the crux of the sentence, right? The words a, for, hyphen, etc. All of these give some comprehensibility or fluency to the text, but they do not give context, much context to the text. And these are heavily used. For instance, the word is used like hundreds of times in your essays and articles, but it does not mean that it is providing context. So keeping them would skew our distribution in favor of some words which occur more frequently. Special markers such as right, tweet, and all of these were removed. We construct the 10 most frequently occurring words by selecting the 10 words with the most frequent occurrence for each class. We find that the term frequently occurring in each class differs significantly. Alright, so different classes have different terms which occur more, which is to be expected. Some tweets are racist, some are sexist. The most frequent tokens for racism are necessary in order to discuss Islam, while discussing women's issues does not require the use of most of the terms that occur most frequently. Alright. We also see a sampling effect of the dataset, as many of the tweets flagged as sexist are generated by viewers of My Kitchen Rules. Similarly and more obviously, most of the tweets flagged as racist pertain to Judaism and Islam. Okay. Lens. So drawing inspiration from Tolkien's et al. 2015. We add average and total the length of the tweets and length of the user description. We expect Lens to discriminate between tweets and that contain hate speech and those who don't. So let's have a look at table 3. So racist tweets have an average length of 60. Sexist tweets have an average length of 52, while neither racist nor sexist tweets have an average length of 57. Alright, so there is some difference, but I don't know if it is much or not. And these are the most occurring words for the different kinds of hate speech, sexist and racist. So we can see their distribution as well. Alright, now the geographic distribution. We find that using location as a feature negatively impacts the F1 score. In order to identify the geographical origin of a tweet, we need to consider more than just the tags Twitter provides, given that only 2% of Twitter users disclose their location. So this would not give a very good score, and we're not even sure if the location is accurate or not. We therefore identify whether any location of the proxy is given in the tweet or user metadata, name and username. In each of the fields, we extract markers indicating geographical location or time zone. Time zone is also used as a proxy of location. Alright, so they did a very smart thing. They tried to identify the user location by not using the Twitter disclosed data, rather the other using these other ways. And they also tried using time zones, because time zones are reflective of location. If a time zone or location is identified, we map it to the longitude and latitude and add to the set of tweets originating from that time zone. If a location name such as Sydney is given, it is also used as a feature for classification. Makes sense. Now let's have a look at the evaluation. We evaluate the influence of different tasks on prediction, different features on prediction in a classification task. They look at a logistic regression classifier and tenfold cross validation to test the influence of various features on prediction performance and to quantify their expressiveness. Alright, so tenfold cross validation is, let me just show you this. I did not cover it in the last video as well. So I'll just cover machine learning cross validation. How about K-fold? Alright, so this is what K-fold, in this case tenfold cross validation, means. For each iteration, you have a different validation data set and a different training data set, and then you take out the performance for each of them and average it out. So you can see if k is 5, then you have 5-fold. If k is 10, then you have 10-fold. So you split it into 10 parts. Alright. You can see these visualizations as well. So model selection, in order to pick the most suitable features, they perform a grid search over all the possible feature set combination and find that using character n-grams outperforms using word n-grams by at least 5 F1 points. So word n-grams and character n-grams have word. So for instance, if we have the sentence I am a boy, then word n-grams would be entire words I am a boy, while character n-grams would only be I, A, M, and so on. So character n-grams, let me show you an example for that as well. So for instance, we have this sentence, then these are character level n-grams, then you have word level n-grams as well. So for instance, the word I occurs 6 times. Let us try to find all 6 times. So I occurs twice here, once in social, once in media, and once in twice in applications. So 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this makes sense. While word level are these things which we saw here. So this is a sentence, breaks into this is a sentence as unigrams. For bigrams, this is one, is a is one, and a sentence is one. And for trigrams, this is a is one, is a sentence is one, and so on. Alright. So they saw that character level n-grams were performing better. So they did not use word level n-grams. To determine whether a difference between two feature sets is statistically significant, we ran bootstrap sampling on the prediction of the two system. The test takes 10,000 samples and compares whether the better system is the same as the better system on the entire data set. Alright. The resulting p-value of the bootstrap test is thus the fraction of samples where the winner differs from the entire data set, giving the p-value a very intuitive representation. Alright. So I probably don't want to go into bootstrap sampling right now. You can just look it up, but it would take me some time because I don't have a very good analogy to explain it. But essentially, it's a statistical technique, and it is used to, in this case, they use it on the predictions of the two systems. So the bootstrap sampling test took 10,000 samples and compares whether the better system is the same as the better system on the entire data set. So when trained on the entire data set, when tested on the entire data set, and when tested on these 10,000 samples, the resulting p-value, which is the value returned by the bootstrap test, is thus the fraction of sample where the winner differs from the entire data set, giving the p-value a very intuitive representation. So I guess this makes sense. In the results, they find that using character n-grams up to length 4 along with gender as an additional feature provides the best results. They further find that using length or length or location decreases the results, and using n-gram features, they achieve the results given in table 4. So they achieve an F1 score of 73.89. And when they add gender and location, gender, it rises to 73.93, while word level n-grams perform poorly. We find that across our features, only adding gender information improves F1 score. All other features do not. The only additional feature that provides an improvement is not statistically significant, whereas the addition of location as well as gender is significant at 0.0355. So features, they collected unigram, bigram, trigram, and 4-gram for each tweet and the user description. To assess the informativeness at each feature, we sum the model coefficients for each feature over the 10 folds of cross-validation. This allows for a more robust estimate. We find that most influential features for the logistic regression largely correspond with the most frequent terms in table 2. So these words are causing the most amount of causing our model to move one way or the other. So you can see that the various n-gram lengths are also present in the table which they've given below, I believe. Yep. For the different n-gram lengths of Islam or sexist are also present. Intuitively, it makes sense that not only will the most frequent term be integrated, but their character level n-grams will be, of course. One of the notable difference between n-grams for our two categories is the occurrence of a gender-based slur and normal words pertaining to women. On the other hand, all of the racist features are n-grams of normal terms, which are reappropriated for building a negative discourse. Alright, so what you're trying to say is, when you look at sexist features, then they have normal words as well as hateful words. But when you look at the racist features, they're trying to use the normal words to create a sense of negative meaning and trying to propagate hate speech, as you can see in this tweet here. So this is an important observation. Then they've reported the scores on gender length, gender plus location, gender plus location plus length. So you can see the different F1 scores when training and using these sets of features. So our score decreases by use of all features as we expected, given the results of using location in combination with gender and length. So using some related works are, at that time, no one was really working in this field. So the related works were on profanity detection, offensive words using list-based methods. So while studies suggest that these are good, robust ways to identify abusive language, this approach is limited to the reliance of list. So if some new slur comes up or some new lingo comes up, you need to keep updating that list. In another work by Shen et al. In 2012, it addresses this by the use of character n-grams among other features in order to identify various forms of bullying. Sood et al. In 2012 also extended their system from statistic lists to incorporating edit distances to find variant of slurs. Alright. So edit distance is something which I can show you, I guess. So there are different metrics to measure edit distance, but basically they're trying to see how distinct two words are. For instance, you have the two words look at and Google, then you'll try to have look at the differences for each word at the character level and identify how different they are. So for instance, in the word intention and execution, you need to delete I, substitute E, substitute X, E remains the same, insert C, and so on. So this is one of the ways. Warner and Hirschberg in 2012 perform a similar task of detecting hate speech using a SVM classifier trained on word n-grams, Brown clusters, and the occurrence of words in a 10-word window. They find that the best model produces unigrams as most indicative features and obtain a F1 score of 63, which is similar to F1 score we achieved using word n-grams. So, if you recall, when they showcased the results, they had a F1 score of 64 using word n-grams, while they also got a similar score using unigrams as the most indicative feature. So now the conclusion, they presented a list of criteria, and this paper was really a stepping stone for a lot of further papers. The data set which they produced was had some biases but was extensive and still extensively used. They started the way for getting a unified definition. The criteria which they described was used like in tons of papers. So in totality, they conclude that they presented a list of criteria, and these can be used to gather more data and address the problem of a small but highly prolific number of hateful users. So this has now grown rapidly. Hate speech and hateful content is being propagated at a high speed, especially due to the rise of bot accounts as well. So there are now a lot of fake accounts which are being used, which are being controlled and generated using softwares. While the problem is far from solved, we find that using a character n-gram based approach provides a solid foundation. Demographic information apart from gender brings little improvement, but this could be due to lack of coverage. So as we discussed earlier, only 2% of the dataset had proper gender location-based annotation. To be precise, only 2% of the users on Twitter disclose their location. So if they can improve this, then they claim that they can have and get to try even better results. So thank you guys for joining in. This was a quick read as compared to the other papers which we did recently, and probably I'll see you guys next time. So like, share, subscribe, all the usual stuff, and comment if you want me to cover any other papers specifically.